Hello everyone, this is Seher from EasyPeasy, and the topic that we are going to discuss today is called as gluconeogenesis. If we look at the word gluconeogenesis, it is made up of three different words. The word gluco comes from glucose. The word neo means new, and the word genesis means production of something. So as you can see, we are going to produce new glucose molecule, but this process will take non-carbohydrate substrate in order to generate that glucose. Now, what happens in our body is that when we have a full meal, our blood sugar level increased. This increased glucose level in bloodstream is going to give signal to our pancreas. And in our pancreas, we have some beta cells and we have some alpha cells. And they produce different types of hormones depending on the need. So for example, right now we have increased glucose in our bloodstream. So it is going to signal beta cells in order to produce insulin and alpha cells to not produce the glucagon. Now these hormones go inside the liver and deliver the signal that liver is not going to produce more glucose because we already have enough glucose in our bloodstream. But, for example, we are hungry and we didn't take a meal. At that time, in our bloodstream, the glucose level is decreased. Again, it is going to send signals to our pancreas, and pancreas beta cells and alpha cells are going to react depending on the need. So right now we have decreased amount of glucose, so beta cell will produce less insulin and alpha cell will produce more glucagon. Now this increased glucagon will send signal to our liver cells that now liver cells are going to use the stored form of glucose, that is the glycogen, and convert this glycogen back into glucose. Now this glucose can go inside the bloodstream in order to balance the concentration of glucose in our bloodstream. This process of converting glycogen into glucose is called as glycogenolysis. Now for example, we are starving and we didn't have a meal for a long time. At that time, the production of glucose from glycogen is not enough in order to meet the need of our body. So the liver cells will use other means in order to produce this glucose. And that includes the amino acids, glycerol, and lactate. And then they will convert back into glucose. And this glucose will go inside our bloodstream in order to balance the concentration of glucose in our bloodstream. This process of converting non-carbohydrate sources into glucose will be called as gluconeogenesis. Now let's discuss why we need this process. Because there are certain organs in our body that use glucose all the time, especially our brain cells. Similarly with our renal medulla, erythrocytes, and lens and cornea. They use glucose as a form of energy. Now let's discuss the pathway of gluconeogenesis. We already discussed glycolysis in one of our previous videos in which glucose converted itself into pyruvate and then this pyruvate converted itself into ADP in order to generate energy. If you didn't watch that video, the link of those videos will be provided in our description box. Now, gluconeogenesis is basically the opposite of glycolysis. There are 70% steps that are reversible, but there are few steps that are irreversible in glycolysis and considered as a checkpoint for gluconeogenesis. And there are three checkpoints in this process. The first checkpoint is the pyruvate kinase that convert phosphenol pyruvate into pyruvate. This step is irreversible. Second checkpoint is phosphofructokinase that convert fructose-6-phosphate into fructose-1,6-bisphosphate. And the last checkpoint is hexokinase that converts glucose into glucose-6-phosphate. Now let's see how this process of gluconeogenesis is going to overcome these checkpoints. Now the process of glycolysis usually occurs inside the cytoplasm of the cell. And after converting glucose into pyruvate, this pyruvate will go inside the mitochondria and convert itself into acetyl-CoA, enters the TCA cycle. But in the process of gluconeogenesis, this pyruvate converts itself into oxaloacetate with the help of an enzyme called as pyruvate carboxylase. Now this oxaloacetate again converts itself back into malate. And this malate is capable of coming out of this mitochondria inside the cytoplasm. Inside the cytoplasm, this malate converts back into oxaloacetate. And this oxaloacetate, with the help of an enzyme called as phosphenol pyruvate carboxy kinase, converts itself back into phosphenol pyruvate. So by this way, they overcome the first checkpoint. The second checkpoint is converting fructose 1,6-bisphosphate back into fructose 6-phosphate. This will be done with the help of an enzyme called as fructose 1,6-bisphosphatase. The last checkpoint is converting glucose 6-phosphate back into glucose. Now this glucose 6-phosphate, in order to convert back into glucose, needs to go to smooth endoplasmic reticulum first. Inside the smooth endoplasmic reticulum, we have an enzyme called as glucose 6-phosphatase. This enzyme is going to convert glucose 6-phosphate back to glucose. And now this glucose is capable to go out of the cell inside the bloodstream. Now let's see how non-carbohydrate substrates are going to enter this pathway. So the first non-carbohydrate that we are going to talk about is lactate. Lactate is basically produced in our body due to anaerobic respiration. For example, if you are doing a tough exercise like running or exercise, the aerobic respiration cannot provide enough ADP in order to meet this sudden requirement. So that's why the cells start producing ADP anaerobically, and the byproduct of that process is lactate. Now this lactate can go back into the system in two ways. Majority of the lactate converts back into pyruvate with the help of an enzyme called as lactate dehydrogenase. And 2% excreted in the urine in the form of lactate. And then this pyruvate can either enter the TCA cycle and enters the mitochondria, or it can make glucose by the process of gluconeogenesis. So lactate converts itself into pyruvate, then pyruvate converts itself into glucose, and this glucose will go back to muscles to make another lactate. If this process is going on and making a cycle, this cycle will be called as Cori cycle. Okay, second substrate that we are going to talk about is the fatty foods. Inside the fatty food, the lipid is usually in the form of triglycerides, as you can see over here. And when this triglyceride is going to store in our body, they will make a tissue called as adipose tissue. So this adipose tissue, in order to meet the requirements of glucose, can go in the process of lipolysis. And this triglyceride will convert itself into two products. One is called as glycerol and one is called as fatty acids. Glycerol can convert back itself into glucose by the process of gluconeogenesis. And these non-esterified fatty acids convert itself into ketone bodies by the process of oxidation. Now let's see how triglyceride convert itself into glycerol and glycerol convert itself into glucose. Triglyceride, by the name telling us that it has a head group of glyceride or glycerol attached with three fatty acid chain. So by the process of lipolysis, the glycerol can separate from three fatty acid chain. This glycerol, with the help of an enzyme called as glycerol kinase, convert itself into glycerol 3-phosphate. And this glycerol 3-phosphate can convert itself into dihydrooxyacetone. Now again, we know how this process is going to be done in order to make glucose. Third and the last most common non-carbohydrate that we are going to talk about is proteins. Proteins can degrade themselves into amino acid by the process of proteolysis. Now this process is done in two conditions. One condition is when you have a full meal, and one condition is when we are hungry. If the protein is coming from our diet, then this protein that will be used in the process of gluconeogenesis will be called as dietary proteins. And the other condition is when we are hungry or on a diet or in a condition where we don't have food. In that condition, this is the last option for our body in order to generate glucose, and then it will use the cellular protein from our body. Now let's see how these amino acids are going to make glucose. If we look at the structure of amino acids, all amino acids have four different things. One is the alpha carbon, second is the amino group, then carboxylic group and R group. R group is basically going to make one amino acid different from the other amino acid. If this amino group that is represented in the blue circle is gonna cut off from the structure like this, then the amino group can be converted into ammonia, and the rest of the compound will be called as alpha keto acids. Now, the most common alpha keto acids that are present in our body is alpha keto glutarate. And when this alpha keto glutarate will take amino group from another amino acid, then it will become as glutamate, which is one of our amino acid. Now, you can see there are two different reactions here. In this reaction, alanine is going to give this amino group to alpha keto glutarate and become pyruvate with glutamate. In the other reaction, we have another amino acid that is aspartate, and this aspartate is releasing this amino group, and this amino group will be taken by alpha keto glutarate and convert itself into glutamate. And aspartate would convert itself into its alpha keto acid, and that is the oxaloacetate. So alanine and aspartate are amino donors, and alpha keto glutarate is basically the amino acceptor and making them the glutamate. Both of these reactions are reversible. So glutamate can give amino group to pyruvate and convert it into alanine and convert itself back into alpha keto glutarate. This type of reaction in which amino group is going to shift from one amino acid to another amino acid is called as transamination. So inside the hepatocytes, that is the cells of a liver, all these glutamates can go inside their mitochondria. And inside the mitochondria, this glutamate converts itself back into alpha-ketoglutarate. Now in this reaction, it is just releasing this amino group in the form of ammonia without giving it to any other amino acid. This type of reaction in which the amino acid releases its amino group in the form of ammonia is called as deamination. Now, almost all amino acids inside our body are basically converted into the major three amino acids, and that is the alanine, aspartate, and glutamate. And as we saw previously, that alanine and aspartate, in order to go inside the liver, it also converts itself into glutamate. And glutamate inside the mitochondria of liver cell converts itself back into alpha-ketoglutarate by releasing ammonia. And this ammonia will convert itself into urea, that will get released from our body. Now, if we talk about the cellular protein that is the last option for gluconeogenesis, inside our muscles, the protein will degrade themselves into amino acids by the process called as proteolysis. And the major amino acid that comes from our cellular proteins are basically the alanine. This alanine converts itself into pyruvate by shifting its amino group to alpha-ketoglutarate, converting itself into glutamate. And this pyruvate can convert back itself into glucose. And this glucose can go back into the muscles in order to generate ATP. This cycle of converting alanine into glucose and glucose back into alanine, if it's making a cycle, this cycle will be called as Cahill cycle. Now, not all amino acids take this one cycle. Some amino acids take the pathway of fatty acid chain, and some amino acids take the pathway of glucose formation. So the amino acids that take the pathway of fatty acids and converted themselves into acetone or acetoacetate, they will be called as ketogenic amino acids. And all those amino acids that will take the pathway of glucose, then they will be called as glucogenic amino acids. So inside the TCA cycle, alanine, cysteine, glycine, serine, threonine, and tryptophan convert themselves into pyruvate. Then asparagine and aspartate can convert themselves into oxaloacetate. Aspartate, phenylalanine, and tyrosine convert themselves into fumarate. Isoleucine, methionine, valine can convert themselves into succinyl-CoA. And arginine, glutamine, histidine, and proline convert themselves into alpha-ketoglutarate. Isoleucine, leucine, and tryptophan convert themselves into acetyl-CoA. And acetyl-CoA will take the pathway of fatty acid chain and convert themselves into acetone or acetoacetate. Similarly, leucine, lysine, phenylalanine, tryptophan, and tyrosine can also take the pathway of acetoacetyl-CoA and go towards the fatty acid chain cycle. Now, over here, you can see that some of the amino acids are duplicated in the yellow box and in the blue box. So these amino acids have the choice of taking the fatty acid chain pathway or the glucose pathway. And only the leucine and lysine are the amino acid that specifically take the pathway of fatty acid chain. So by this way, all these amino acids enter the TCA cycle at different checkpoints. And if we are going towards the process of gluconeogenesis, then when it reaches to malate, the malate will go out of this mitochondria and follow the pathway that we already discussed in this video. That's it for now. Thank you very much for watching this video. As a part of our EasyPeasy Expert membership, you will get access to the notes on this topic and practice quizzes. Take very good care of you. Bye for now.